Okay, so let me tell you what's been bothering me lately. Every day, more than once a day, I need to do all these power switch acrobatics just to turn on and off all these different accessories. And yeah, I get it, first world problems, but seriously, I probably waste a minute or two every day turning on and off and adjusting all this stuff. First, there are these two stupid lights behind me here. While these lights are nice and they have all kinds of different colors and intensity adjustments, the remote is absolutely ridiculous. The buttons don't make any sense, and I probably only use like four of them. Actually, most of the time, I really only need to do two things, on and off. Second is this TV that's above my monitor. It kind of acts like a second mega monitor, and I use it for all kinds of secondary display stuff. I also use it as a light source for videos, like I am right now. Again, there's an entire TV remote, but all I really need is to turn it on and off. Third is the camera, the one you're watching me on right now. I use this camera for lots of things, but it generally lives right up on my monitor, and it acts as a webcam for my normal day-to-day video conferencing, but you can't leave it on all the time, and there is no remote. So anyways, you get the point. I need these things automated. And for that, I have a plan. For Christmas, I got this, a Stream Deck Plus. It has so many knobs and buttons, and I so badly want it to be the control center of my entire setup. Now, I've already done the basics. It sets up my apps, it controls my mute button, it controls the record button for recording these videos. But you know what it doesn't do? Pretty much all of the stuff that I just explained. So now is the time to fix that. First things first, I need some stuff. Let's take a look at the stuff I got. First, just some basic smart plugs. These plugs are made by a company called Kasa, and I got them mostly because they were affordable and had good ratings. Second, the Broadlink RM4 Pro. This thing is essentially an IR and RF blaster that can imitate commands from any normal remote control as long as it isn't Bluetooth. Third, a dummy battery for my camera. This provides continuous power through a fake battery, so when the power is turned off to the plug, the camera turns off. So with all of these smart things, I should be able to make this happen, so let's get it all wired up. One note about these smart plugs, they kind of take up a ton of space. It's like they were made for plugging into a wall outlet, but I have a power strip, so that took a little creative wiring. So do me a favor, don't tell my wife about this power strip plugged into another power strip I have going on here, okay? Anyways, before I do anything fancy, I think it's best to do how it's described in the instructions. So let's RTFM. For the smart switches, all I need to do is download the app, set up a stupid account, give away my identity, detect the switches, and bam! I can turn on and off the camera and the lights. Now, the TV is a little more complicated. This thing I got, called the Broadcom RM4 Pro, is essentially a smart IR and RF blaster, but it only knows what to blast after a little bit of setup. So you can either search on the little store thing, or you can program it yourself. Since I only needed to do a handful of things, I opted to program it. You essentially take your existing remote, point it at the RM4, then press the button. It records the command, and bam, that's it, it's working. Okay, so now I just turned my two remotes and a manual switch into one remote that I have to control with two apps on my phone, and that's cool and all, but still not exactly what I'm going for. What I really want is to control this stuff programmatically, and I think I have a plan for that. You may or may not already be familiar with this, but there is a little program called Home Assistant. It kind of acts like a smart home hub of sorts. You can add all your smart things to this hub, then control them all from one central place. You can even make non-Apple approved smart stuff work with the Home app on your iPhone, or really whatever you want. Sky's the limit here. But really what I want is the ability to control Home Assistant with my Stream Deck. So first thing to do is set up Home Assistant, then figure out how to control it with the Stream Deck. Before I get into all the Home Assistant stuff, it would be pretty awesome if you would like and subscribe. It helps the channel a ton. Thanks. So since I already have a Kubernetes cluster running on these Mac minis behind me, I'm gonna set up Home Assistant on there. Okay, as usual, setting up stuff like this has its quirks. Luckily for you, I just did all the struggling, so you don't have to. To add Home Assistant to the Kubernetes cluster, I used this Helm chart I found on the interwebs. I'll put a link in the description. The chart itself does fine, but there are a few undocumented things that might hang you up. I'm running Kubernetes on an Ubuntu machine running microkates. It's a super easy way to get Kubernetes running on a small server, but the important thing here is that I have microkates installed with the following add-ons enabled. All right, so I have core DNS turned on. I have the host path storage turned on, which is just a very basic way to get disk access, and we are using it in this project, so you will need to have it turned on. I have the ingress controller turned on, and I have metal LB. Those two things will allow you to have, one, a load balancer that uses your host network, and two, an ingress controller for routing things to your cluster. And then finally, I just have metric server so I can see what's going on. So if you have a cluster set up and you have those add-ons installed, the next thing to do is install the Helm chart. Here you can see all the values I set when installing the chart. Some of these were a little tricky, so let's just take a minute to review. First thing at the top is the environment variable for time zone. In my case, this is America, New York, but go ahead and set it for your local time zone. The next one is the host network, and you want to set this to true. This is going to make it so the pod that is running Home Assistant has access to the network in your actual house, your real LAN with the real IP addresses. If you don't set this, you won't have any access to actually get to the IP addresses of the smart devices, and the system won't work at all. Next is the ingress. This is setting up Home Assistant so you can reach it with a host name. This is obviously enabled true. If you're using microkates, you do need to set the WebSocket services for Home Assistant, and you need to set the ingress class to Nginx because that is the ingress controller that's running. And then go ahead and set your host name. I used this host name that's on the screen. You set your own, and you can set the your DNS to point to the IP address of your cluster, and that'll get you up and running. For me, I've enabled persistence and set that to true. This is storing the Home Assistant configuration to a persistent volume. In my case, it's a host path volume. The next is the database of choice. For me, I chose InfluxDB. You can choose other databases. They're all available in the Helm chart. Again, just setting this to enabled, and the rest of this is pretty much copy and paste. The one part that you do want to pay attention to is the auth. For me, I have admin and the password and the token. That password and token is generated the first time you install it, and it won't be here in your values. What you want to do is go into your cluster, find the secret for the InfluxDB password, and pull that data out and put it here. So next time you do a deployment, that password won't try to be overwritten. It actually won't do a deployment if you don't have that, but those values set. Again, here with the database, I'm setting persistence to true. We're using host path for the storage, and I've got 8 gigabytes of storage. Finally, add-ons. This is the code server add-on, which I'll talk about a little bit later, but this makes it so you can view your configuration in VS Code running in your web browser. So this is set to true, and the rest of it is just copy and paste from the example values that are in the Helm chart. After you get all that done, it's just a one-liner to install Home Assistant. Okay, now that it's installed, I can log in and configure all of the integrations. As you can see, it immediately found a whole bunch of stuff that's already connected in my house. I really just need to add support for the new stuff. So first, let's add support for the smart plugs. To do that, I need to go to the integration section and choose to add an integration. The Kasa smart plugs are one of the many pre-built supported devices, so just search for Kasa and then add the integration. It was that easy. After that, there they are. I can turn the plugs on and off with just a flick of this virtual switch. So that covers the camera since it's just the switch, but the lights are a little bit more challenging. To set up the light, I figured out that I need a combo of the smart socket as well as the IR blaster. Essentially, I'm going to create a virtual switch in Home Assistant that will get the status of the light from the smart plug status, then use the IR blaster to control the color of the lights, either white or color. But before I do that, let's set up the RM4 Pro IR Blaster so it can send the two different power commands to the lights. One command for the color lights on and off, the other command for the white lights on and off. While programming the RM4 IR Blaster isn't exactly simple, it is a one-time thing, and here's how it's done. First, add the Broadlink RM4 Pro integration the same way as the smart plugs. After you get the RM4 integration installed, go to the developer menu in the Home Assistant and click on the services tab. From there, search the list of services for remote learn command. Next, in the target section, choose the RM4 Pro remote as the target. This is telling Home Assistant that this device is the one that will be learning the new signal you're about to send. Next, in the device and command column, put the name of the device you want to control and the name of the command you want to send. This is telling Home Assistant the name of the command, so when you send it, it will store it that way in the configuration. In my case, I called the device lightbar and the command white lights. Later, I'll also add a color light command to the lightbar device. After providing those details, click the blue call service button. Then grab your remote, point it at the RM4, press the button you want the device to learn. You should see a green check appear on the Home Assistant screen to indicate that it was able to learn the command. Next, click the Go to YAML code link at the bottom and copy the YAML text. You will need this later. Go ahead at this point and program all the buttons you want, grabbing the YAML code each time and saving it to into a doc somewhere. Okay, now that you have those commands, you want to edit one thing. Change the service line from remote.learnCommand to remote.sendCommand in the doc that you've been storing all of these things in. Okay, now there's a couple things that you can do with these commands. First, you can just put them in scripts, so you can just run them individually, or you can do more fancy things like combine them with other commands and devices to essentially get the effect you want. I'm gonna do both, but let's first do the simple script. If you set up Home Assistant with the example code I provided, you also already have an easy way to edit your configuration. Go to your browser and enter the Home Assistant URL with the port number 12321. What you should get is VS Code running in your web browser with all of the Home Assistant configuration and files available on the left-hand side. I highly recommend setting it up this way so you can have an easy way to modify your configurations. Open up the scripts.yaml file and add your scripts just like you see on the screen. Most of this config is the commands you copied and altered earlier, but just with two extra lines. The first is the name of the script, and the next is the sequence indicator telling Home Assistant that there may be a number of commands. In this example, we just have one per sequence, but you could have many. Now just save the file and go back to Home Assistant and reload the configuration. At this point, you should be able to go to Settings, Automations, and Scenes, then click on the Scripts tab and see your scripts. If you click on them and flip the switch, they should send the command and control your device. Now, that's all well and good, but I need more than that. I really want these dumb lights to act like real switchable smart devices. I want to be able to turn them on and off and choose color or white. To do this, I'm going to use a virtual switch. On the screen is my config for the three virtual switches that I've made. Now, everyone's use cases will be different, so I'm going to go through this pretty quickly. Essentially, the way these work is you first provide a condition that tells Home Assistant if the device is on or off. In my case, with these light bars, I'm just checking the state of one of the lights, since they both come on and off at the same time. Below that, you'll find the turn on and turn off sections. These contain the instructions on what to do when turning on or turning off the virtual device. For me, with these dumb lights, I'm running a series of commands that will ensure the light is either on or off. The short version of this is turn the smart plug on to provide power. That's easy. Next, since we don't actually know the current state of whether the light is on or off, if I want white light, I first hit the color light button that will turn the color lights either on or off, then press the white light button that will guarantee to be turning on the white lights. Then just do the opposite for turning it off. After creating your virtual switch, save it to your config and then reload the config in Home Assistant. It'll throw an error if you have any syntax problems, and I found that the errors are somewhat helpful. At least they tell you the exact line where the problem is, and that's a start. Now my virtual switch is listed in Home Assistant as an entity and works just like a normal switch with the on and off capability. Wow, okay. All the Home Assistant stuff was a journey. I'm sure after I edit this video, the whole thing will be like a minute or two, but for me, it took like hours in real life. But now, finally, I can do the thing I really wanted to do in the first place. Add these switches to my Stream Deck. And this part is actually super easy. First, launch the StreamDeck configuration program on your computer. Go to the little plugin store thing and search for Home Assistant. Install the plugin. For the first device you add, it'll ask you for the address of your Home Assistant WebSocket URL. It's essentially the URL you've been using to get to the Home Assistant UI, but with a different protocol and a different path. If you're doing like me and have this set up to work on port 80 or 443, then just leave the port off the URL. Next, you're going to need a Home Assistant API key. Go back to your Home Assistant UI, click on your name, and go to the bottom. Click Create Token and then copy that token. Put the token into the Stream Deck screen, then hit Save and reconnect. It should now show all of your domains and entities. So now just pick the switch, pick Toggle, give it a name, and hit Save. And we're done! Hey, if you're into this stuff and you like this video, maybe consider liking the video and subscribing. I'd really appreciate it. Thank you. As you can see, now I have all my switches and they all work exactly the way I want. In the Stream Deck, you can make multi-switches and turn on and off multiple devices or really whatever you want. So now I have one last thing. How much did all of this cost? Well, overall, I think it was pretty affordable, but I also had some advantages. The smart plugs were $30. The RM4 Pro IR Blaster was $45. The dummy battery for the camera was $25. The Mac Mini was free to me since it was a hand-me-down, but your mileage may vary. And the Home Assistant software is obviously free. And finally, I'm not sure it counts since I got it as a Christmas gift, but the Stream Deck Plus was $199. I put links in the description if you want to buy any of this stuff, and if you buy with the links, I get a little kickback, which is pretty cool. All right, thanks for hanging out all the way to the end. Check out these videos in the corner since YouTube seems to think you'll like them. Until next time, happy coding.